Thank you. So, we're more than a decade into Android and iOS. Both systems have grown, both platforms have grown, apps are beyond what people originally envisioned them to be. How do we develop apps? So the canonical approach, or let's also call it native approach, although the word is highly overloaded, I'm still using it here. So the canonic native approach to do an Android app used to be developers write it in Java. Nowadays, they're mostly using Kotlin. Then you have an iOS team, iOS developers, who are using Objective-C, or these days Swift, to develop their apps. So since all of those systems grow, we are seeing more and more specialization in iOS and Android development. Many of our companies have adopted feature teams for development, yet the developers for mobile are less and less cross-functional, but more and more specialized. So for a number of reasons, a number of people have asked themselves whether there is a simpler way to develop apps. So let's briefly visit four alternatives. I'm not yet promising to you that they're simpler, but they're alternative approaches. So first up, ReactNative. ReactNative was introduced by Facebook in 2015. What you're doing is you write an app now in JavaScript. You do write the logic and the UI in JavaScript. And yet, it is not a web view-based solution like those very, very old approaches for cross-platform that most of us totally did not like because they had a bad user, they created a bad user experience. But the actual rendering is done by the operating system, by the native components. Yet React Native needs to prepare for that and prepare the layouting. And there is a bridge that all of those UI calls need to cross. That's why also there are some limitations in what you can do with a React Native UI. And there's some speed performance issues as well. So because of the limitations, also some developers tend to go back to native UI for some things they could not do in React Native itself. But also bear in mind, React Native, the core of React Native is currently being rewritten in order to let this go away, and there will be hopefully a new version, not 2019, but at some point of time. Next up is Xamarin. Xamarin was bought by Microsoft in 2016, and it is the approach of bringing .NET and C# development to mobile. So developers write their logic in C#, and they, in the beginning, they were also they were keeping to use iOS and Android separately, but could still write their app in C# because Xamarin brought WordPress for them. Yet the rendering is done of native UI components. Because people wanted to share more codes, Xamarin Forms was introduced so that there are three approaches now. There's another approach where you can also have a shared UI code for both platforms. So in the end, this looks a bit similar to the picture we've seen from React Native. So let's come for something else. Google introduced Flutter in 2017. Now developers are writing their apps in Dart for both UI and logic, and all of this code is shared. And rendering is now not done by the native systems, but rendering is done by the Flutter engine. So you can think of the Flutter engine like a game engine that is doing all of the rendering for the apps. And this is made possible by a rewrite of UI components. So Flutter comes with its own UI components, material for Android, and they call it Cupertino for iOS. Fourth, a more lightweight approach, backed by JetBrains, who also invented Kotlin. Now we're back to developing two apps, one for Android and Kotlin, one for iOS, probably in Swift, and they're sharing only the business logic. So you do write a shared lib in Kotlin for your business logic, but you make use of the Kotlin multi-platform libs So you can also, for example, put your network layer in there. For Kotlin multi-platform, it's still a bit early, but this is something that is growing, and so the multi-platform support is also growing. Well, obviously, on each of these platforms, you could fill an entire conference on by itself. So that's why I'm not going to go deeper into the details right now or tell you what else you could do with it, but I'll rather give you some bold statements to think about. So when I first seen my team switch from the dual implementations to a cross-platform project, it was a relief because we were no more building the same thing twice. A lot of friction was removed. I mean, think alone of Jira tickets that you need. Oh, we clone them for iOS and Android and blah, blah, blah. All this was gone, but instead we were focusing on features. Also, platform-specific bugs still existed, but they become the total exception instead of the default. Yet there is no such thing as a free lunch. I mean, for sure, introducing multi-platform is not buy one, get one for free, because you are removing the two, you're removing doing everything twice, but you're also introducing a new complexity by introducing a new tech. But that's not the only thing. There's also additional cost that you need to think about when it comes to a cross-platform system. So some of this additional price tags you need to consider are inherent to the architecture of the cross-platform system. So I've mentioned ReactNative, which has a performance hit due to the JavaScript bridge. We've had Xamarin, which brings all of .NET to mobile. This comes with the price of bundling .NET, which is big, so these apps tend to have a slower startup time. And there's Flutter, which has rewritten all of your UI components, which comes with a price potentially on consistency with the target operating system. Second area where there might be a price, depending on the platform you chose, is that it sometimes feels it still is early for the platform. For some, this is true because it is early, but on the other side, the cross-platform system will always lag behind because also Android and iOS keep evolving. So naturally, you always might hit a point where there is something you want to do that is just not there for your platform that you've chosen. Last summer, there were some blog posts by Airbnb who said they are sunsetting React Native because their goal was, instead of two platforms, we are supporting one. And they learned, well, actually, we support three now, iOS, Android, and React Native. And there is some truth in here. I mean, to a certain extent, you will need your specialists unless you're doing a trivial app, which is good too, because, I mean, totally you can do your side project in Flutter even if you don't know iOS. But for a real-world production application, probably the specialists need to come in at some point. Yet, not all of the time. So there is a lot of code you can share among the platforms. But I started with saying, well, we no longer do. iOS and Android developers become so specialized. And of course, introducing a new technology is disruption, and you may disrupt this silo mentality by introducing a new tech stack. But that's, of course, not the only solution. And also, cross-platform is more than just technology. It's also about taking ownership for those platforms and understanding that. So even when you decide to stay on the two different native tracks, there is something you can do about that, about enforcing cross-platform thinking and encouraging people to think about both platforms. So one approach I've learned up at a Berlin meetup was from a company who set up their team to build an entire greenfield project by pairing an iOS and Android developer. And thus, they got a lot of understanding of the other platform. Plus, they were not sharing code, but they were sharing ideas. So, I'm sorry, there is no silver bullet. There is no easy answer. What I did, what my team did, my team selected out of those alternative development options, we've selected Flutter for both the learning curve and the high quality of the resulting apps. Yet, still, we decide on a per project basis. I'm working at an agency, so per project, we decide whether to give it to the team who's doing native development or to the cross-platform Flutter team. Last, so pick what is right for you and your team with your team. Thank you.